So as B.F. Skinner kind of comes up with this theory of behaviorism in the 1930s, it becomes more and more popular to the point where if you look at an ed psych journal in the early 1950s, it is 100% behaviorism. I mean, whether we're talking about teaching, learning, behavioral reinforcement, everything is really built on this idea of behaviorism. And by the time the 1960s roll around, psychologists have started thinking about the idea of pigeons in boxes and start to think that maybe humans are slightly more complex than pigeons and that more may be going on between our ears and that difference may matter. And so it gives rise to a whole field of theories called cognitive psychology. And so when we think about cognitive psychology, those theories are really related to human thought and what goes on kind of inside of our brains that may not be evidenced in behavior, but then leads to and changes our behavior. And so one of the theories that comes out of that in the late 60s, early 70s is a theory called self-determination theory. And these two guys named Ryan and DC come up with it. And it's a theory of motivation that's really linked to how we as humans have uniquely evolved to take advantage of being in social situations and living together. Self-determination theory essentially posits that humans have three overarching needs. We have a need for autonomy, which means in this literature really the desire to be in control of ourselves, the desire to be the ones making decisions about what we're going to do. And so kind of the opposite of autonomy is being controlled or manipulated. So anytime we feel like we're making the decisions and we're deciding, we tend to be happier, we tend to have a stronger sense of well-being, we tend to develop in a more positive way than when we are constantly manipulated. And so if we want to think about the parallel process, for teachers that work in a school where they come up with their own lesson plans and they decide what they're going to do from day to day, they tend to be happier than teachers who teach off a script or who get told, you know, you're going to be on page 37 of the teacher's manual at 11:30 a.m. or you're in big trouble. And so all of us want to experience autonomy in our daily lives, including children. The next kind of basic need that Ryan and DC posited was the need for relatedness. So when we're around other people, we have a need to connect with others. We can all think about jobs that we've had where we hated everyone's guts that we worked with. I'm sure that's not the case for anyone today, but at some point in our lives, we've had to work with people we don't like, and when we have to do that, we tend not to like our jobs as much. And we experience a decrease in our well-being, and we experience a decrease in our motivation and our positive engagement. And so so that can be something that either motivates or restrains us as our fulfilling our need for relatedness. And finally, we all have a need for competence. So at a very early age, infants, 3, 4, 5 months old, they just want to have an effect on the world. They put things in their mouths, they grab at things. By the time children are 1 or 2, though, they don't just want to have an effect on the world, they want to kind of succeed at whatever tasks they undertake. And so really, competence is about the decision that we make that we have succeeded somehow at a task in whatever way we define that. And so when we succeed at the tasks we undertake repeatedly, we tend to have a feeling of competence, and that leads to positive well-being and positive engagement and positive motivation. So Ryan and DC really posited that everybody has these three basic needs, and when the environment helps us fulfill those needs, then we're going to experience positive well-being. We're going to be intrinsically motivated. And when the environment frustrates those needs, we're going to actually have a decreased sense of well-being. We're going to have decreased developmental trajectories, and we're going to just feel less good about ourselves and about our lives. The other piece that Ryan and DC kind of add to our picture of motivation is they posited that not all motivation is equal, right? So in behaviorism, either you do the action or you don't, and that's really all that behaviorism cares about. Ryan and DC said, wait a minute, there are lots of different reasons that a person might have for doing something, and understanding those reasons could maybe shed light on how we can motivate them in the future. And so if you've ever heard the words intrinsic and extrinsic motivation, they actually come out of this theoretical framework. Originally, they posited that all motivation was either intrinsic or extrinsic. After doing research on this for 40 years, we know that that's actually not quite the case. In fact, it's not really two sides of a coin, but rather it's a whole continuum that goes from one end to the other. And so if we think at one end, intrinsic motivation is anything that we do where the task is the reward, that we don't have to have any external pressure. Nobody has to tell us to do it. You know, I love reading a good book. I love playing video games. I love taking a nap. Nobody has to bribe me to take a nap. And so I'm intrinsically motivated to do those things. And so that really lies at one end of the continuum. At the other end is amotivation. So we can all think about a time where we asked a child to do something in the classroom and they just sat there and stared at us. That is amotivation, is literally not moving. And so these are really at opposite ends. And in between those is a continuum of different things that we are externally motivated to do. So all the way down at the end next to amotivation is, if I tell you to do something and the only reason that you have to do it is because I told you to, then that is external extrinsic motivation. And it's right down next to amotivation because when we motivate people and the only reason that they have to do something is because we told them to and it's completely external to the value of the task itself, we tend to get kind of begrudging behavior or maybe behavior that complies but doesn't go any further than that, or maybe it's behavior for now and as soon as I look away, it's not the behavior that I want to see anymore. And so all of those things are kind of characteristic of external extrinsic. Kind of the next level up is if I have a reason outside the behavior itself, but it's a reason that's maybe personally valuable to me, right? So I go to the gym 3 or 4 times a week. I lift weights. I run. Those things, when I'm doing them, make me miserable. Running is just hateful torture. I know there's some people out there who are saying, but what about my runner's high? The runner's high comes later. The running itself is misery, right? But running and lifting weights and going to the gym, they help us feel and look a certain way. They help us to be able to walk when we're 70. And so that is a reason that's valuable to me, external to the task itself. So I'm more likely to go to the gym, even though I may dislike what I'm doing when I'm there, if the reason that I have to go is an internal one. And then right up next to intrinsic motivation is if I walked into a room and asked everyone to stand up and walk out of the building and stand in the parking lot for 30 minutes, people would look at me like I was crazy. But if I walked into a room and said, I need everyone to stand up and walk out of the building and stand in the parking lot because the building is on fire, people would get up and they would move, right? And even though I kind of authored the behavior externally, the identification behind that is really internal. And so as soon as people hear my reason, they get behind that, and it's almost as if it was internally authored. And so when we think about how we're motivating kids in the classroom, it's important to think about this. How am I motivating kids? What is the kind of driving force here? And are they just doing this because I've asked them to do it? Are they just doing this because I've promised them something that's got nothing to do with the task itself? Have I asked them to do it, and have I explained why I want them to do it, and am I kind of inviting them to understand that? Is what I'm asking them to do something that's going to help them to get to a goal that maybe they have for themselves? All those different things are things that we can think about when we're asking children to do things that will help us either motivate them or fail to motivate them. And the degree to which we can kind of move up toward this internal end of the continuum is the degree really to which we will actually get children on board with what we're asking them to do day by day, hour by hour, and minute by minute. When we think about how to support children's autonomy in the classroom, I think there's really a few different ways that we do that. Let's think about pros and cons for self-determination theory, right? Because in the long term, if we can motivate children by fulfilling their need for relatedness, if we can help them feel autonomy, if we can help them feel competent in our classrooms, then we're going to have a lot of success in the long term in getting them to do what we want. But there are costs to this approach, just like there are costs to any other approach. And the real cost behind self-determination theory is that it really works most effectively with children who are fulfilling their needs in kind of the way that most of us do, right? So if we think about kiddos with autism, they have a need for relatedness just like everyone else, but they may be fulfilling it in a radically different way. You know, fulfilling their need for relatedness may not look like a hug. You know, it may look like something completely different. And so for children where they're fulfilling their need for relatedness, for example, in a very different way, trying to fulfill that need in the usual way can really be ineffective, can actually maybe take us in a direction that we don't want to go, or it can take us backwards and maybe make behaviors more challenging and reduce motivation. And so for children who have really kind of non-normative ways of fulfilling their needs, this can be a challenging approach to use. And then the other con, of course, is that building relationships takes time. Building up children's desire for autonomy while setting clear boundaries at the same time can take months to do, right? And so this is a technique and a theory that really pays off in the long term, but in the short term, in the moment, it can be very challenging to leverage a relationship that you don't yet have with a child to get them to do something at the very beginning of the year. And so it actually works really well because the strengths for behaviorism, which is that it's very effective in the short term, are actually the weaknesses for self-determination theory. And so when we're very sensitive and we think clearly about how we pair these theories, particularly with our kiddos who maybe are fulfilling their needs in different ways, we can create a much stronger way of interacting and motivating them than we can by using either of these approaches in isolation.